Happy Monday, guys. It's Dave. Welcome back to the channel. And today I want to round up the rest of the news in the space industry for space stock investors. After last week, we just had so much dang news around Rocket Lab that I had to devote a full video to that one company. Although I do have to admit it bias there, it is my biggest investment and my favorite company to follow. However, there is a lot of news around a lot of other big players that could have important implications, not just for those individual companies, but for the entire industry as a whole that we should not miss. So let's get to the latest space stock news. Before we do that though, if you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing to the channel, and every like and comment does always help out. Thank you guys so much for continuing to support. First of all, I have to apologize again. There is still construction going on right outside my door, so you may hear some of that picked up on the mic. Not too much I can do about that, unfortunately. I do apologize. But on to the latest space industry news. First of all, of course, we have to talk about ViaSat. If you're not too familiar with it, there was a massive blow for the company that just happened. They did have a satellite that launched on a full Falcon Heavy rocket, and not only that, the boosters did have to be expended in order to get this large satellite into the proper orbit. So definitely not a small failure, like when you just say have one out of a massive constellation fail. This is an extremely important and extremely expensive satellite. And of course, the stock responded appropriately, dropping from around $43 per share all the way down to $29.93. So a massive blow for any ViaSat shareholders, and you have my sympathies for this failure. Definitely extremely rough for any company in the space industry when they have a mission fail, especially an important one like this for the company. So, of course, the CEO did say that he is disappointed by these recent developments, and the satellite suffered a malfunction while deploying its reflector. Now, ViaSat themselves did not disclose the identity of the reflector's manufacturer, but its design appears to match products offered by Northrop Grumman. So a good chance that this reflector was built by Northrop Grumman that ultimately failed. Goes to show why every single part is so important in terms of their flight heritage and their success heritage. Northrop Grumman did not immediately respond to a request for comment, but we did hear from an industry publication that if the satellite is lost, ViaSat might end up triggering a $420 million insurance claim. I don't know why these things always come out to 420 or 69 or something like that. It's crazy to me how often this happens. But anyway, that would be a massive insurance claim and very difficult for any insurance company to absorb, even an extremely large one, which could have a lot of implications on the future of insuring space vehicles in terms of premiums having to be increased and even more scrutiny put on the reliability of space systems and launchers. Now, that $420 million claim would not even cover ViaSat's full cost. That's only about 60% of the cost of the mission. The remaining 40% would be a blow to ViaSat themselves. The mission cost is estimated to be around $700 million. So a massive blow to ViaSat, a big industry-changing event, and we hope that they are able to bring that satellite back online, but I don't think it's going to be able to be serviced way out there where it is located. Next up, of course, we have the big BE4 engine failure that received so much attention and discussion lately. CNBC initially reported that Blue Origin suffered this failure. It's not something Blue Origin announced or disclosed. It was found out, and only then did we hear Blue Origin's comment on the issue. So apparently this firing was back on June 30th at Blue Origin's facility in Texas. The engine detonated or exploded after about 10 seconds into a acceptance test. Of course, first priority is that no people were injured, and then an investigation is underway. A lot of discussion on whether this is going to cause further delays to the Vulcan, which, as we know, has already been delayed so many times, most recently by an explosion on a test of their upper stage Centaur vehicle. That one was due to a hydrogen leak. Now, there was some interesting updates on Twitter from about this by Tory Bruno, and I have to say I'm really coming around to his style, and I'm starting to like him a lot more these days. I know he's kind of, I guess, what you might call an old school CEO, but he's very open on Twitter and can be very entertaining as well. He did say that he thinks it's very unlikely this will cause any setbacks for Vulcan. This is just an acceptance testing. It just seems to be this one engine that failed and not a design problem for all BE4 engines. Continuing on, he said that this was their 15th test of the Centaur upper stage when this explosion did occur, and there's a lot of questions like, why did this happen so late in the testing? Shouldn't this issue have been caught way earlier? Well, he said that there's different test trajectories that create a variety of different stresses they put the vehicle under. They finally got to this stress level or this stress profile on their 15th test when it finally did explode. So for corrective action, they will add a ring of stainless steel around the door near the leak site, as well as a strips of stainless steel to reinforce the dome. This is going to cause significant weight increases, but apparently shouldn't be a problem for any of their currently planned payloads. The vehicle does have the margins and the capacity to handle this additional weight because, as we know, with rockets, any additional weight you add to the rocket is weight that you can't deploy into space. Bruno does say that they still expect to be on schedule to launch for the fourth quarter of this year. I hope they do. Wouldn't surprise me at all if they do encounter further delays. This vehicle has been delayed so many times already. Bruno continued on saying, I'm flattered by the attention that we now have. A routine acceptance test was colorfully discussed on social media, but this really isn't news. So definitely trying to downplay this as much as possible. Now, this might actually be the most interesting thing I heard about this whole thread is when asked about the BE4 production rate, Bruno said that the current rate is 2 engines per quarter, which is ramping up higher over time. But to me, 2 engines per quarter really doesn't sound like very much. So this engine is being relied upon not only for Vulcan, but also Blue Origin's New Glenn. I'm not entirely clear on this, if this is just 2 engines devoted to Vulcan per quarter, or 2 engines in total per quarter. If it's the latter, to me, that spells big trouble unless they can really ramp up the production. But that's even so. If this is just for Vulcan, we're only talking 1 launch per quarter right now because each Vulcan does need 2 BE4 engines. So that's 4 Vulcans in a year. Certainly not the kind of cadence you're really hoping for. That said, hopefully they can ramp up this production. Although the BE4 engine has had so many problems, so many delays and issues. Not too shocking, I guess, that they're only at 2 a quarter. And the total added weight on the Centaur upper stage is going to be about 300 pounds. Very thorough briefing by Tory and ULA. On to Intuitive Machines, who've had quite a week, quite a crazy stock movement. We can see that on the 7th, they had a massive jump from 850 all the way up to 10, which is above their go public price of $10 per share. And another drop again. So what's going on with Intuitive Machines? Well, their big Nova C lander, which I did make a video on myself, didn't get a lot of views, but if you're interested, I would highly recommend checking it out, could potentially end up being the first private company to land a lander on the moon, depending on some scheduling issues with some competitors as well. It did pass a complete spacecraft test run, so making it one step closer to landing in space and on the moon. Very exciting update on Intuitive Machines. And that's why the stock did have a big bump, but of course it's a very volatile company and it did end up coming back down. CEO and co-founder of Intuitive Machines did say that this test run represents a crucial step forward in validating the performance of the entire Nova C lander on its way to the moon. Continuing on, it sounds like the first launch of Amazon's Kuiper satellites will no longer be on the ULA Vulcan rocket due to all these aforementioned delays that have been continuing to hit the vehicle. So the first launch is now going to be on an Atlas V rocket in September, according to Tim anyway, from Twitter. Definitely looking forward to see that first launch of Amazon's Kuiper constellation, because it does represent a massive investment in the space industry, and that flows down to all sorts of suppliers and other companies, as well as other launch companies as well. So on to some big news from the NSSL Space Force program or contract, whatever you want to call it, basically how the Space Force is procuring launches into space. This whole program is a really big deal and represents massive amounts of money for the companies involved. It's extremely important to developing new rockets and extremely important for a lot of companies. Now, Lane 1 is currently where Rocket Lab's Neutron plays, where they have their contracts. And at Lane 2, up to this point, has only included SpaceX and ULA, but they are now changing Lane 2 from 2 to 3 companies, meaning a third launch provider will be included. This will be very big news for whoever does grab that third spot. There has been some speculation that maybe Neutron, maybe Firefly's MLV could compete. The majority of people think that New Glenn is pretty much a lock for the third company. So in order to be able to compete for Lane 2 launches, the rocket must be able to fly payloads to 9 reference orbits, which include some very demanding missions. The final RFP is scheduled to be released in the fourth quarter of this year. Lane 1 awards are expected in the third quarter of 2024. So definitely looking forward to seeing the awards for both Lane 1 and 2. Now, I did find some of these reference orbits we're looking at being able to need to be hit. And I am not entirely sure whether Neutron can handle all of these. Definitely need to dive into that more. If Neutron were somehow able to get into this lane, obviously it would be a big win. But even just Lane 1 is really, really great and really important for the rocket. So it'll be interesting to see whether Blue Origin and New Glenn do pick up the third place. There's not a ton of other rockets really available at this point that, you know, could compete for it. There was an interesting interview on a CNBC Space podcast with Firefly's new CEO. He talked about a variety of different topics which might be of interest to us. They're apparently getting very close to completing a new capital raise. Now, we know the market has been quite bad for some of these more speculative space companies. Of course, Firefly is still private, so it's a little bit of a different market versus the public markets. But he does say that they are oversubscribed in this funding round, which is good news for Firefly. He also mentioned that he's very confident over the next 2 years in the demand for their Alpha rocket, but he wouldn't commit to continuing to launch it beyond 2 years, saying that kind of depends on how demand shapes up in that 1-ton payload range, saying it would really be demand-driven whether they continue launching it. And then just a brief comments on going public, when Firefly might go public, and retail investors like us could hop aboard. He says macro conditions would play a big role in deciding that, so perhaps a little later on, you know, interest rates coming down, maybe markets getting a little more frothy and people willing to go out on a limb a little bit more on these companies would be a better time. These are just my words, of course. He's also said they would like to have Alpha flying monthly and be getting close to being good to go with their medium launch vehicle in order to be a good public offering. So we could be a little bit ways out from a public offering, but he definitely said it is, you know, on the table in the future, if any of you Firefly fans out there are looking to invest. And then just one piece of news from Redwire here I thought was pretty interesting. They're going to be building a new factory in Indiana as the company looks to increase production of critical technologies enabling human spaceflight missions and commercial microgravity research and development in low Earth orbit. So very big new 30,000 square feet facility. Definitely a big investment for the company. Hopefully it does pay off for them in the future. Finally, we also have the date for Virgin Galactic's next flight after their first successful commercial flight back on June 29th. So they're not quite hitting that one per month cadence yet. The next launch will be August 10th, but actually quite impressive, to be honest. I thought it would take them a little while longer to get ready to go with that next flight, doing tests, refurbishment, whatever else they might need to do. But August 10th, the next flight, and hopefully once a month going forward for Virgin Galactic. So that's all I have for you today. Some really devastating news for ViaSat, possibly Northrop Grumman as well, if it was their component, and implications for the insurance on the whole space industry, as well as a lot of interesting news around Blue Origin, ULA, Intuitive Machines, NSSL contracts, and more. Let me know which piece of news you think was the most interesting down in the comments below. I hope you guys have a great day, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now. Yeah.